بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. قال الله تعالى في كتابه الكريم: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، يا يحيى خذ الكتاب بقوة وآتيناه الحكم صبيا وحنانا من لدنا وزكاة وكان تقيا وبرا بوالديه ولم يكن جبارا عصيا وسلام عليه يوم ولد ويوم يموت ويوم يبعث حيا. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
I would like to begin by congratulating you all on the auspicious occasions that we are celebrating during these days and nights. One of which is the birth of Imam Muhammad al-Jawad alayhi salam, whose birth falls on a day like this, on the 10th of the month of Rajab, in the year 195 after Hijrah. And inshallah, in two nights is the celebration on the 13th, the eve of the 13th of Rajab, is the birth anniversary of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, who was born 10 years before the Ba'tha of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. 10 years before Rasulullah took on the message of Islam. And these are, both of them are our imams. Of course, Amir al-Mu'mineen is the father of the imams, and he is the greatest of the imams, and the first Muslim, and the first to be with the Prophet, the first to defend the Prophet. Amir al-Mu'mineen was born in the middle of the Kaaba. This is one of the honors that Amir al-Mu'mineen had, that no single individual has had that honor. He was born in the middle of the Kaaba, and it was during the month of Rajab. The month of Rajab, even before the religion of Islam, it used to be a season of Umrah. It used to be a time where even the Jahiliyyah, they used to go and they would perform Umrah. So Masjid al-Haram was full. I don't know if you saw some of the pictures that came out of Mecca today, where Masjid al-Haram was empty today. I don't know if anyone saw that. This is something that even before Islam, Rajab used to always be a season where Masjid al-Haram was full. This is why this emptiness is something that's very strange, especially during the month of Rajab. Fatima bint Asad, the mother of Amir al-Mu'mineen, she begins to feel the pains of labor. So she goes to do tawaf around the Kaaba. They were living in Mecca. She goes to do tawaf around the Kaaba and she says, "Oh Allah, I believe in you. And I believe and the message of the one who built this Kaaba," referring to Prophet Ibrahim. And the parents of Amir al-Mu'mineen and the Ahlul Bayt, they were muwahideen, they were monotheist. They did not believe in idols. She says, "Make it easy for me, make this wilada easy for me." Historians say that the wall of the Kaaba started to split open. And she went in there and she gave birth to Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. And she came out 3 days later carrying this young newborn child. And the first one who was there to take him and hold this child was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa alayhi. Even though this was before the Ba'tha of Rasulullah, but Rasulullah, he would help out Abu Talib, because Abu Talib raised the Prophet and he took care of the Prophet. Abu Talib, when he was at an old age, he needed help with his children. So Rasulullah, he took it upon himself to raise Ali ibn Abi Talib. He used to raise Amir al-Mu'mineen. And this is why Amir al-Mu'mineen, he says in Nahj al-Balagha, he says, وَلَقَدْ عَلِمْتُمْ مَوْضَعِي مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ بِالْقَرَابَةِ الْقَرِيبَةِ. And then he says, وَلَقَدْ وَضَعَنِي فِي حِجْرِهِ وَأَنَا وَلِيدٍ. He carried me in his lap when I was a waleed. I was a newborn baby. وَأَنَا وَلِيدٍ يَضُمُّنِي إِلَى صَدْرِهِ. He brings me close to his body. He says, I would smell the scent. I grew up smelling the scent of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. This is Amir al-Mu'mineen. And we all know that Amir al-Mu'mineen was the first to believe in the Prophet. And the first to defend the Prophet. He was born in the Kaaba, in the holiest place of worship. And he died during the holiest act of worship. He was killed when he was in the state of sujood, prostrating to Allah in Masjid al-Kufa, in the mihrab of Masjid al-Kufa. So born in the Kaaba and struck on his head in Masjid al-Kufa, and in between he lived a life of service to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What can we say about Amir al-Mu'mineen? He was a man who his enemies and the ones who loved him, they both hid his good merits. Why? His enemies, it's obvious, we know why they would hide the merits of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Because of their hatred, because of their jealousy of Amir al-Mu'mineen. They took many of the titles of Amir al-Mu'mineen and they gave them to others. The title of As-Siddiq, this is the title of Ali ibn Abi Talib. He says, أنا الصديق الأكبر. I am the Siddiq. وأنا الفاروق الأعظم. And I am the Faruq. Faruq is the one who distinguishes between right and wrong. But of course they came and they gave this one Siddiq and that one Faruq, and the titles were given out to other people. And this is the power of propaganda that was against the Ahlul Bayt, and until today it's against the Ahlul Bayt. This is one. We know why the enemies of the Ahlul Bayt, they hid the merits of the Ahlul Bayt. However, even those who loved the Ahlul Bayt, they were afraid to come and speak of the fada'il and the praise of the Ahlul Bayt out of fear for their lives. Because if anyone says a hadith, qala Ali ibn Abi Talib, they would be killed. Qala Abu al-Hasan, he would be killed. This is why there was a time they used to say, sami'tu an Abu Zainab, qala Abu Zainab. They were afraid to say the name of Ali. They were afraid to say the name of Abu al-Hasan. They would say Abu Zainab said this, referring to Amir al-Mu'mineen. So, despite his enemies brought down his merits, and his friends and those who believed in him did not announce his merits, the merits of Ali ibn Abi Talib are still so great until today. I'm going to stop here with regards to Amir al-Mu'mineen. I want to talk about Imam al-Jawad alayhi salam as well. We all know about Amir al-Mu'mineen, Imam al-Hasan, Imam al-Husayn, but not many of us know about Imam al-Jawad and the later on Imams. Imam al-Jawad alayhi salam, he lived for 25 years. Can you believe it? The ninth Imam of Ahl al-Bayt, he lived for 25 years and he was poisoned at the age of 25. However, even despite that short age, Imam al-Jawad managed to accomplish so much. First of all, his wilada, his birth, was a blessing for all of the Shia. Why? Because when Imam Musa ibn Ja'far al-Kazim alayhi salam died, he was poisoned in the prison of Baghdad. He had some wukala, he had some deputies who would represent him. When Imam Musa ibn Ja'far, the seventh Imam, passed away, some of the deputies, they refused to accept the Imam of Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam. They refused to accept the Imam of the eighth Imam. Some of them, because they wanted to hold on to the money that they had. They had the money that was belonging to the Imam. They don't give over to Imam al-Ridha. So they came and they said that Imam Musa ibn Ja'far, he's in a ghaibah, he's in an occultation. And this was the beginning of one of the فرق, one of the sects within the Shia by the name of the Waqifi sect, Al-Waqifiyya, meaning they waqafu ala al-Imam al-Kadhim. They stopped believing in the other Imams and they stopped believing at Imam al-Kadhim alayhi salam. Imam al-Ridha, he comes to them, Imam Ali al-Ridha, he comes and he tells them, I am the Imam, and he proves that he's an Imam. They tell him, some of them believe in him, some of them don't. One of the questions that people had with regards to Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam, they tell him, you don't have a son. You don't have a son. Subhanallah, Imam al-Kadhim, he had over 30 sons. Imam al-Ridha had one son, and that was Imam al-Jawad alayhi salam. They tell him, you don't have a son, and we know from the signs of the Imams that the Imam has to be kamil, meaning the Imam should not have any faults, should not have anything that is bringing him down. So someone not having a son, although that's not something wrong, however, they say that you should be able to have a son. Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam, he tells them, yes, you're right, every Imam has a son, and I will have a son. And a few weeks or months later, Imam al-Jawad alayhi salam was born. And when Imam al-Jawad was born, many of those Waqifi who had stopped and did not believe in Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam, they came back to the tashayyu'. They came back to believing in Imam al-Ridha with the barakah, with the blessing of the birth of Imam al-Jawad. This is why Imam al-Ridha, he says about Imam al-Jawad, he says that his wilada, the birth of Imam al-Jawad, a'zamu baraka ala al-Shia. It is the greatest barakah upon the Shia, the birth of Imam al-Jawad, because it brought back so many people, they started believing in Imam al-Ridha once again. So this is just his birth. Of course, the mother of Imam al-Jawad alayhi salam, she was a slave. She was a slave from Africa. Al-Khayziran al-Nubiya. Nubiya means the land of Sudan, Africa. And this teaches us that the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, they did not discriminate between Arab and non-Arab, white and black. And Allah says in the Quran, وَلَأَمَةٌ مُؤْمِنَةٌ خَيْرٌ مِّن مُشْرِكَةٍ وَلَوْ أَعْجَبَتْكُمْ وَلَعَبْدٌ مُؤْمِنٌ خَيْرٌ مِّن مُشْرِكٍ وَلَوْ أَعْجَبَكُمْ. Sometimes if someone is a mu'min, if someone is a believer, even if they're a slave, of course she was a slave, then the Imam freed her. The Imam purchased her and freed her, and she became the mother of the Imam. And this shows us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at you for who you are, looks at you for your iman and your faith and your taqwa. Allah does not look at your status, where your family's from, what last name you have, which village you're from. Allah does not look at that. We look at these type of things. Allah does not look at that. So the mother of many of the Imams, they were slaves who were brought from all over the Muslim world, all over the empire. They were brought, and then the Imam would purchase them, the Imam would free them, and the Imam would marry them, and they would become the mothers of the Imams. So this is why one of the descriptions of Imam al-Jawad, Imam al-Kadhim, Imam al-Ridha, the Imams, some of them, they had dark skin. The Imams today, you see, when they draw the picture of Jesus here, what do they draw a picture of? A blonde, blue-eyed European guy. Well, that's not how, I don't know how Jesus looked like, but the Imams, we know that the description is that they were not. Some of them, yes, they were light-skinned, some of them were dark-skinned. And in the eyes of Allah, that doesn't even matter. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. Another very important point regarding Imam al-Jawad alayhi salam is that he became an Imam at the age of 7. At the age of 7, his father, Imam Ali al-Ridha alayhi salam, was poisoned in Khurasan, in Mashhad. He was poisoned, and the Imamah transferred to Imam al-Jawad alayhi salam. He was the only son of Imam al-Ridha, and he became the Imam. Now, some people found it hard to believe. Some people said, how could a child, someone who's 7 years old, become an imam? But our imams, they prove their imamah, one, through being chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. chosen by Allah through his father, Imam al-Ridha. He says, the Imam after me is Imam al-Jawad, just like Amir al-Mu'mineen was chosen by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Today some Muslims, they say the Prophet who worked so hard, the Prophet who made sure he builds this religion, he guides people, he was hurt, he was abused, he was assaulted, he was attacked. They say the Prophet died without appointing anyone. If you're a shop owner, if you have a shop, a small shop, you want to leave it for an hour, aren't you going to leave someone there? Or are you just going to say, you know, let people decide who takes care of it? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he was the most knowledgeable person. Of course he's not going to leave this ummah in the hands of people who, a lot of them were munafiqeen, a lot of them were mu'allafati qulubuhum, a lot of them, they had just come from the shirk, they had just come from Mecca. So, same with Imam al-Jawad, each Imam is chosen, this is one. And second, the Imam has signs to show that they're an Imam. And Allah says in the Quran that some prophets of Allah, they were young and they were prophets. Isa alayhi salam, he was an infant. His mother carries him. قَالَ إِنِّي عَبْدُ اللَّهِ آتَانِيَ الْكِتَابَ وَجَعَلَنِي نَبِيًّا. Similarly, Yahya, John the Baptist, the son of Zakariya, Allah tells him, يَا يَحْيَا خُذِ الْكِتَابَ بِقُوَّةِ وَآتَيْنَاهُ الْحُكْمَ صَبِيًّا. He became a prophet when he was a sabi. He was a child. He was a young boy. وَحَنَانًا مِنْ لَدُنَّا وَزَكَاةً وَكَانَ تَقِيًّا وَبَرًّا بِوَالِدَيْهِ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ جَبَّارًا عَصِيًّا وَسَلَامٌ عَلَيْهِ يَوْمَ وُلِدَ وَيَوْمَ يَمُوتُ وَيَوْمَ يُبْعَثُ حَيًّا. So if you believe in the Quran, then it's not difficult for you to believe that an imam becomes imam at a young age, right? If you don't believe in the Quran, that's a different issue. But if you believe in the Quran, today some people, they come and they say, how did the Mahdi, these Shias, they believe in the Mahdi, a five-year-old imam. Okay, Isa was an infant and he was a prophet. If you believe in the Quran, you'll accept that. Yahya was a child and he was a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, the reason why Imam al-Jawad became an imam at a young age, because they killed his father. And similarly, Imam al-Jawad, he was poisoned when he was 25 years old. So Imam al-Hadi also became imam when he was 8 years old. And Imam al-Hasan al-Askari was killed young, he was poisoned young. Imam al-Mahdi becomes an imam at the age of 5. Because towards the end, during the Abbasi era, they did not have patience anymore. That's it. They would poison them right away. Imam al-Jawad alayhi salam proved his imama, proved his knowledge through debating with the scholars, the top scholars of his time. He would debate with them. They say that one day Al-Ma'mun, he's the son of Harun, and Ma'mun is the one who poisoned Imam al-Ridha, and he made Imam al-Ridha migrate all the way to Khurasan. Ma'mun, he goes to Medina and he sees a young child. He has an entourage. He has a huge entourage. He's walking with his entourage in the road. There's kids on the street. There's kids on the road. They all run away when they see this entourage. One boy, he stays standing. He's standing. So Al-Ma'mun, he sees this boy, he's standing. He's surprised. All the kids ran away, but this boy is still standing. So he comes to him. And he tells him, why didn't you run away like all the other children? All the other boys, they ran away. He tells him, the ones who run away, they're the ones who have done something wrong. I have not done anything wrong. Or the one who has to move is the one who's in the way. I'm not in your way. Your entourage could go. So he sees the confidence in this child. He tells him, what's your name? He says, my name is Muhammad. He tells him, the son of who? He says, the son of Ali. The son of who? The son of Musa ibn Ja'far. So he realized that this is the son of Imam Ali al-Ridha. The son of the one who was the crown prince of Al-Ma'mun, and Ma'mun poisoned him. So he wants to test this child. Al-Ma'mun, he had gone out hunting. He has a falcon in his hand. And he has a bag that's also in the other hand. So he tells him, I want you to tell me What's in the bag? What do I have in the bag? The bag is sealed, it's closed. So Imam al-Jawad, who's a child, he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates fish that swim in the ocean that are hunted by the falcons of the kings, so that the kings ask the sons of the prophets, what's in the bag? He tells him, the kings, they come and they want to ask the awlad al-anbiya, the children of the prophets, because he's from the descendants of Rasulullah, they want to test them what's in the bag. So of course there was a fish in the bag, and Al-Ma'mun was shocked. So Al-Ma'mun, he comes and he brings Imam al-Jawad with him, and he is stunned by his knowledge, and he forces Imam al-Jawad to marry his daughter, to marry the daughter of Al-Ma'mun, Umm al-Fadl, who she was the one who ended up poisoning, along with Al-Mu'tasim al-Abbasi, the brother of Al-Ma'mun. She poisoned Imam al-Jawad. He brings him some of those scholars, the big scholars in the government. They come and they tell Ma'mun, what are you doing? This young child, he's 7 years old. You're coming and you're treating him in such a way. He tells them, you don't know him. I know him. Ma'mun, he knew the status of the imams. He knew that the imams were the most knowledgeable. But sometimes when you have love for power, it deceives you. So one day he comes and he gathers some of the big scholars, and he brings Imam al-Jawad alayhi salam, and he tells them, ask him any question. Ask him whatever you want. I believe he's the most knowledgeable. Because they tell him, why are you giving this young child to marry your daughter, and why are you treating him in such a way? So one of the scholars at that time, who was the head judge, Yahya ibn Aktham, he asks Imam al-Jawad, he sees a seven-year-old child. He tells him, "Ma taqul fi muhrimin qatala saydan." What do you say about someone who's in the state of ihram? When you go to Mecca, when you go to Hajj, either in the Umrah or the Hajj, you go into the state of ihram. It's haram to kill, to hunt in the state of ihram. So he tells him, "Ma taqul fi muhrimin qatala saydan." He thought that, that's it. He's going to ask him a difficult question and the imam is not going to know how to answer. So the imam tells him, you have to ask your question correctly. Did he kill the sayd inside the haram or outside the haram? Did he kill it on purpose or not on purpose? Was it a sheep or was it a bird type of animal? Was it the egg or was it the not egg? Was it during the day or night? Was it... All, he asked him 9 different questions. Yahya ibn Aktham, he says, I don't know. He was shocked. So he tells him, you tell me. And Imam al-Jawad begins to answer him with regards to every single one of them. Every single one of them. And everyone realized that Imam al-Jawad, even though he looks like a child, but he was the most knowledgeable. Of course, Imam al-Jawad alayhi salam, he wanted to leave the palace and go to Medina. He says, خبز شعير وملح وقبر رسول الله أحب إلي. He says, I would rather go and eat wheat, hard bread, and salt, and have the grave of Rasulullah next to me. This is better than staying in the palace. But the Khalifa would keep forcing the Imam to come to Baghdad until Al-Mu'tasim Al-Abbasi poisoned Imam. He poisoned Imam Al-Jawad alayhi salam, and he was buried next to his grandfather, Imam Musa ibn Ja'far alayhi salam, in Baghdad, in the cemetery of Quraysh. And the grave of Imam al-Kadhim alayhi salam, and the grave of Imam al-Jawad, and the graves of all of the imams, has a barakah. Let me conclude with this hadith. One of the narrators, he tells Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam, he writes a letter, I believe Zakariya ibn Adam, his name is. He writes a letter to Imam al-Ridha. He tells him, I'm in Qom, the city of Qom. He tells him, I want to leave the city of Qom. He was a scholar, this man. And people would go and they would take their fiqh and their ahkam from this man. He tells him, I want to leave the city of Qom. So Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam, he tells him, لا تفعل. Don't leave the city of Qom. قال زكريا ابن آدم رحمه الله قلت للرضا عليه السلام إني أريد الخروج عن أهل بيتي فقد كثر السفهاء. The Imam عليه السلام, he writes a letter to him. He tells him لا تفعل فإن أهل قوم يدفع عنهم بك البلاء كما يدفع عن أهل بغداد بأبي الحسن موسى بن جعفر. اللهم صل على محمد. He tells him stay. You're a scholar, you carry the hadith of the Ahlul Bayt. Stay in the city because Allah will protect the people of Qom through you, just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protects the people of Baghdad through the grave of Abu al-Hasan Musa ibn Ja'far, of Imam Musa ibn Ja'far alayhi salam. So this is the position of the Imams, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give quick healing and shifa to all of the Shia of the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, and all of the mu'mineen who are dealing with the pain and the sickness. And a lot of them are in the holy cities right now. They're in the holy cities and they're suffering. We have to do dua for them. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect them and to protect you all. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu ala muhammadin wa ala alihi al-tahirin.